Arts Roundup with Simon Bertin on Cambridge 105 Radio.
Welcome to Cambridge Arts Roundup, an hour of art stories on talented people. As we finally top up the PIMS and celebrate the beginning of the new season, there's some exciting stuff going on in the city which we might have to be quick to catch before it moves on. In this edition, we get immersed in the visionary world of artist and poet William Blake in a meaningful journey through his life at the Blake's Universe exhibition at the Fitzwilliam Museum with curator David Bindman. We talk to world-famous harpist Janet Harbison on her contribution to music, education and the Irish harp revival. We brave the daggers, hatpins and silenced Colt 45s at Cambridge University Library at the Murder by the Book exhibition on crime fiction. And Cambridge artist Robert Good previews his new show on how new technology might make us or break us after his trip to Silicon Valley, as he asks us to step back and look at the life issues of tech through art. Charting the spiritual, religious and creative waters of the world within has been a preoccupation of moral men through the ages. Enlightenment artist and romantic poet William Blake's genius was perhaps devoted to finding an intellectual path through it that later made reason's syncretic sense and coherence to people and their dilemmas in an age where he himself was often seen merely as a rebellious mystic. A new exhibition, Blake's Universe, at the Fitzwilliam Museum is currently showcasing artworks relevant to Blake's story and his creative work and poetic narrative, which arguably has instilled in us a new perspective on our own humanity, and his visions capture elements of the better angels of our nature. The exhibition reframes Blake's life and personal universe with a greater degree of accuracy about the origins of the ideas surrounding him that he worked with, bringing him to life in historic context as a genius who made something entirely new, combining poetry with artistic design, igniting a visionary imagination that we can share. Co-curator David Bindman is Professor of Art History at University College London and has worked with the Fitzwilliam on many projects.
The concept was really to get away from the idea of Blake as a kind of isolated genius, a kind of little Englander who never went anywhere, which is in a sense true, he didn't go anywhere physically. The argument is really that Blake is really part of a large international movement that involves a lot of other great artists, and at almost every stage in his career he's in some sort of dialogue with artists or art from another country. So it begins with basically Italy, and of course that's the home of classical art, but also the Renaissance, and you can see his upbringing as an artist, and connections are all really connected to Italy. And then the middle part of the exhibition, which is on revolution, is about the French Revolution and the idea of revolution engulfing Europe. And the third part is about, I suppose, the reaction to the French Revolution, the rise of a new spirituality among romantic artists. And there Blake is in some ways has a lot in common with the artist Philip Otto Runge. And so it has these three sections and a kind of progression from looking at the past, the present and the future.
Blake believed that the life of the imagination was much more important than the material life, didn't he? He was someone who lived in this visionary world, but he wasn't really recognised during his life at all.
Yes, I mean, he was deliberately in opposition to the Royal Academy, for instance, to what was going on at the time. So he's regarded as a rebellious figure. He simply didn't produce the kinds of works that were saleable at the time, you know. And his main job, amazingly, was as a copy engraver. He was someone who spent his days poring over a copper plate copying other people's designs. His imaginative works are his night thoughts, things that he did when his mind was wandering as he was working on these copper plates. So he's very much in that sense. I mean, he is a lone genius, but that doesn't mean to say he isn't connected with Europe in quite a wide way.
It's well recorded that he experienced visions as a child, which I suppose is in many ways the beginning of his story.
Yes.
And then he went and became a workshop apprentice, Bazier, at Lincoln's Inn Fields. And he spent a good number of years engraving, etching. He was someone who was very driven and also quite extraordinary in many ways, I think.
Most of the other painters that he knew had social ambitions. They wanted to be, you know, gentlemen. They wanted to be prosperous and sell their pictures. And Blake simply was content, I think, to be a working man. I mean, there's a freedom in what he did. I mean, the fact that he could, you know, make his living, not a very good one, from copy engraving, did mean that he wasn't in competition with anybody, particularly in the middle section, where you've got a magnificent series of plates from America, a prophecy in Europe, prophecy, and in the final section we've got a selection of plates from Jerusalem, his, you know, great masterwork really, in 100 plates. He was someone who didn't believe in religious institutions. He was completely opposed to the church. In fact, he didn't really believe in government either. And the point about the man of the compasses, he's the god of the material world, and Blake is all for the spirit. So it's the spiritual world that he's appealing to, not to the material one.
He seemed to be making an attempt to make sense of the world within, appealing to people's sense of social justice and the need for some kind of revolution in order to make that all happen in life.
I think that's right. I mean, you can look at these, the sort of story behind the illuminated books as what's called a psychodrama. That's to say, it's between these competing forces that are within the human mind. So I mentioned imagination at the beginning. And imagination is a human faculty that's at war with man's reasoning capacity. And at the moment, Blake argues, it's the reason that is dominant, and therefore, you know, material reason. So people are only concerned with material things and not with the imagination and the spirit. The other way to look at him is he was really what's known as a millenarian. Mm. And a millenarian is a person who believed that the world was about to come to an end, according to the prophecy of the biblical book of Revelation, which is to say that angels of destruction will come down and destroy the material world and then allow the redeemed, who are the spiritual people, to triumph and build the new Jerusalem. But these are also processes that on one hand, they're temporal and historical, but they're also within the mind itself. He talks about redemption as something that has to be reenacted daily. You have to keep a sort of redemptive process going and renew it each day. It's a very special belief, really. But, I mean, there are quite a lot of people who believed that the world was coming to an end. And one of the reasons they felt that was that there were all these incidents that were happening in their own time, things like the Great Plague of London, Great Fire of London, the outbreak of the French Revolution. All of these were seen as signs that the world was coming to an end.
Now, who were his friends and contemporaries?
Well, I think a lot of people shared the ideas in, to some degree. I mean, the sort of radicalism and the belief in the, you know, revolution was something that quite a lot of people in Royal Academy shared, a lot of artists did. He knew all the major people in the Royal Academy quite well, and they came to his defence at one point. So he wasn't without friends or contacts.
Can you take me through some of the key exhibits? But which ones really would you pick up on as highlights?
Well, one of the things we tried to do was not to focus on individual objects, but things that told a story by being put together with each other. The first thing you'd want to look at, I think, going into the gallery is a series of engravings of Joseph Arimathea. And it begins with a print after Michelangelo, from a figure from Michelangelo's Last Judgment. And then you've got proof of an early apprentice work that Blake did, which is a copy of it. And then you've got the final version, which he does when he's mature, and where he takes this figure and makes him into, re-identifies him as Joseph of Arimathea. But Joseph of Arimathea is an important figure in Blake. He's also a kind of figure of the artist. And the idea was that Joseph of Arimathea came to England after being involved with Christ and set up the first church at Glastonbury, but he found England extremely inhospitable. And Blake argues that someone like that, bringing the truth, the true revelation, is like artists of all ages find that they're always unpopular with the public. And he talks about the Gothic artists and, of course, also Michelangelo. What we did was we decided to focus on America and Europe because of the theme of revolution. We've got a selection of 6 plates from America. We had the whole of 18 plates of Europe. And these copies belonged to John Linnell, painter who looked after Blake in his last years. And they're beautifully hand-coloured. I mean, so we've made quite a feature of those. And those tell the story of Blake's sort of social beliefs, his opposition to slavery, and Blake's idea of what he calls mind-forged manacles. Mind-forged manacles are simply the idea of slavery as something that's also spiritual slavery. You know, you're enslaved mentally as well as physically. He sees the British people, in fact, people in Europe and everywhere, in this form of mental slavery that they need to be liberated from. And that's very much stimulated by the book America, which is about the American Revolution, which is the start of the cycle of revolutions in his own day.
Wasn't he someone who became disappointed about the results of revolutions after they'd happened at the same time, though, wasn't he?
And I think he felt it hadn't succeeded. I mean, his hope was that the whole world would be caught up in revolution. And it's discussed in some of the other books as well. The revolution is the culmination, as far as he's concerned, of history, going back to the creation of the world. He's got a kind of view of history as something that's, you know, the way ends with a revolution. But of course, it doesn't actually happen. And his hope is always that, as he says, you know, that one day he hopes that everyone, God's children, will be prophets. He wants everyone to be a prophet. And he keeps that idea going, just as a number of romantics in Germany, like Philipp Otto Runge, also had a similar idea. And artists were the ones who, if you like, opened up the possibility of redemption.
Dante's watercolours are amongst Blake's richest achievements, but he also criticised Dante as well, didn't he?
Well, Dante was a Catholic, didn't like the Catholicism of Dante, and he doesn't feel that Dante really understood the nature of redemption. And so, yes, I mean, there's a very strong critique of Dante's Inferno running through the illustration, and you know this because not only from the imagery, but he also scrawled rude things about Dante on some of the unfinished drawings. So we know what he thought of him, yes.
In this making sense of the world within, he developed a kind of private mythology and complex symbolism, which also appears in his art. Can you give us some examples of that?
One of the things that people ask all the time is, you know, why does he use these names that no one's heard of, like Urizen, Los, and Orc? I think that one of the reasons is that Blake doesn't want to be understood too quickly. I mean, he wants you to work at these things and live with them, and even spend your lifetime interpreting them, which he wants to keep the mystery. I think the other reason that you have these separate names is he wants to say that what he's doing is quite different from anybody else. I mean, this is his own mythology. This is something he's constructed from all the mythologies of human history. It's what's known as a syncretic myth. It's something that pulls them all together. So he labels, well, Urizen is probably a slight pun on your reason, but Orc and Los is also creates the sun, so it's perhaps Sol backwards. So there are connections between the names, but he does, invent them, and it's, some of them are quite straightforward. You know that Orc is the spirit of revolution, but a lot of them, who knows what they mean? I mean, it all adds to the kind of mystery of his work. And he was thinking, I think, very much there of the Bible, where you've got all these different characters, often lists of people that you don't know who they are at all.
Now, what was he like in real life? Are there anecdotes about his life which are told through the exhibition?
Well, I'm not sure we tell them through the exhibition, but plenty of anecdotes about his life, yes. Mm-hmm. I mean, he was very plain-speaking, unaffected person who dressed like a working man and, you know, was proud of being a craftsman. And he was, I think, had people remark on his extreme sweetness of nature. He was clearly someone who was quite compelling as a person. And these younger artists in the 1820s, like Linnell and Samuel Palmer, clearly adored him and flocked around him and hung on his every word. So he did become a kind of guru, I suppose, to some younger artists.
So etching was a technique which was an innovative aspect of his art.
But what he does in the illuminated books, the prophetic books, he invents a whole new technique. Etching uses acid. And what he did was, if you think about an engraving, that prints by incising lines on the copper and squeezing the ink out on the paper. But the relief in etching process, it prints from the surface, and you use the acid to eat away the parts that don't print. And no one had done that before. And the reason he did it, I think, was it was a way of combining text and design quite freely. You had a lot more possibility of just simply moving from writing into design. And you see amazing effects in some of the works that he does in America. For instance, there's one plate where you see flames eating up the text. You know, and that's something you can't do with engraving and the standard way of illustrating a book. Blake is really extraordinary because he's both a great poet and a great artist. But more than that, he combines the two in these illuminated books. I mean, they are, you know, in my view, great poetry, but also great art. But what they create is something completely new, which is something that's, you know, both art and literature, in a sense, neither. And that, I think, has had a great influence. It had an influence on Rossetti, who was both a poet and an artist, and many others, I think, in the 20th century have had that feat, that ambition to be both poet and painter. He was, I think, probably the most successful of all of them because he was so gifted. A friend of mine put this rather well, I thought. He said, Blake's the kind of person whose philosophy you can live by. And there is a kind of core in Blake that is very distinctive and in some ways very appealing as well.
Being musically gifted is something that both mystifies and delights us when we see it in others. And sharing such a talent with the world is sometimes more difficult than it looks. Well, one such light who performs in Cambridge has been sharing her experiences of life at the top. I've been talking to internationally renowned Irish harpist Janet Harbison on her teaching career, playing and composing music, and her contribution to the Irish harp revival. Janet's often played to Cambridge audiences to rapturous applause and won nearly every prestigious award you can compete for, and is also a professor of music and an author. Thank you. That was Stranford Water, a beautiful piece of music by world-famous harpist Janet Harbison, who's actually with me now, and we're going to have a little chat about her career. First of all, tell me a little bit about yourself. You're a professor of Irish music, a composer, and a very well-renowned performer of classical and traditional Irish folk music. You play the harp exquisitely, as everybody knows. How did it all begin for you as a musician?
Well, it was all about being a maverick, I think. I started off by being trained as a classical musician, but I had always got an interest in Irish traditional, mainly because it was a very social instrument, and it was an instrument you could jump into a session, which is like a jam session. So it was always frightfully social. It wasn't competitive. And in my training, all of my background was in competitive playing. You had to be the best. You had to beat somebody else in a competition. You had to beat somebody else in an interview, or not an interview, but, you know, to try and achieve a part in a performance. You were competing at every level. And I found that glorifying on one level, because it was nice when I'd win, because then I'd beaten everybody. But then I ended up with few enough friends because I'd beaten them all. And that's one thing I realised, is that by beating your friends means you don't end up with any. So I love the social aspect of traditional music. And I got into it not for any purist purpose, but because I also met lots of interesting people, and I got deeper into the traditional music because I loved to play with pipers. I found something very appealing about Illan pipes, which is the old Irish pipes. But it's not that old. It's only a 200-year-old tradition. But in the piping repertoire, there was all this old ancient harping music, because the pipes, when they domesticized from the, you know, war pipes or bagpipes, as we would be more familiar, this music, it was like the older music for piping, as in Scotland you would know it as pibroch. In Irish music, it was the epic music that was part and parcel of the early Irish courts. Now, it wasn't that I was desperate to be a historian, but I found the music intriguing and I wanted to perform it on my modern nylon strung Celtic Irish stroke Japanese harp. I just found the music and the story behind it intriguing. So that's really where I started, and I was very lucky in that I was quite visible, having had my glorious moments in the competition, to get invited on concert tours. And once I got a feel for a bigger audience, I'm afraid I got a bit hooked on the high that you get by being a performer. And a lot of the time when I was performing in groups with other traditional musicians, I had this yearning to try and organise them a bit, which is not always conducive to being purely relaxed and social. So when I started teaching, and this happened quite by chance, not by design, because I'd always said, I'm way too good to be a teacher. I'm going to be traveling the world. I'm not going to be bothered sitting down and teaching people week on week. But that's exactly where I ended up, and loving it, because for the Belfast Harper, there was a very important event in Ireland in 1792. And that was the gathering of the old harpers, because it was recognised that their tradition was in danger of disappearing. And I was a young research fellow at the Institute of Irish Studies in Queen's University at the time, looking into my ancient music from manuscript sources. But when this anniversary was coming up, because I started that in 1986, and the anniversary was coming the anniversary was in 1992, a bicentenary, and somebody idly said to me, we would love to have a great harp concert to commemorate this event. And I said, oh, okay, well, there aren't that many harp players. In fact, there's practically no harp players in Ulster and Northern Ireland at the time. So I said, I'll invite my friends from around the world, and maybe have Derek Bell from the Chieftains, if he's not touring, and invite one or two people up from Dublin. Oh no, we don't want you. We don't want famous people. We want the youth of Ulster. We want the young children of Ulster to play. And I said, but there isn't anybody playing. There is no. And that was mainly because of the political issues in Northern Ireland. So the challenge was meted out to me, and I thought, oh my gosh, okay, if this is to be part of my work. So it was conceived also as an opportunity to bring children together from both communities in Northern Ireland, because nobody knew what to make of the harp. Was it a classical or traditional instrument? Was it a unionist or nationalist instrument? Was it a Catholic or Protestant instrument? I loved the fact that nobody could figure this out, and I said, right, this is an opportunity to see if we can kind of gentle the connection between the two communities. So I jumped in, and within 4 years I produced an orchestra of youngsters, and we were ready for the bicentenary in 1992, and within a few months months of the programme, we won a Grammy Award because I fixed it, that we performed with the Chieftains, which is a veteran Irish, well-travelled, world-famous group. Immediately, we got jettisoned into a very visible place, and we won a Grammy for the recording we produced with the Chieftains. And in a way, my future was set. However, my heart was in the business of creating this cross-community interaction in Northern Ireland. So for 22 years, that was the core of my work.
So, I mean, you've dedicated a huge part of your life to bringing Irish culture to life and expressing it in music. And that's been a major contribution. And I've heard you play in Cambridge to rapturous applause. And you've spent some time in the city doing concerts here and visiting us. I mean, how much...
And with my orchestra, actually.
With your orchestra. And how much of a contrast is the Cambridge audience to Dublin when you go out there? I mean, how do you find it?
We came from Northern Ireland. We were conceived and contrived within Northern Ireland. And it was very much about telling the Northern Irish story to a world audience or to an audience outside of Northern Ireland, rarely to Ireland. Because matters Northern Irish in Ireland were fairly unpopular, mainly because Northern Ireland was a terrible pain in everybody's heart. And certainly it was in England too. But there were, you know, during the time that my orchestra was operating, because we launched in 1992 and we went to 2002. So it was an 11-year adventure. And then the politics put me in a couple of horrendous places. And I ended up with PTSD because my neighbours were firebombed. We were living in treacherous times, but they weren't always treacherous. In 1994, in September 94, we had the ceasefire where the IRA declared that they would, you know, cease their operations. The Loyalists didn't cease theirs for another year. But in the meantime, we suddenly became a visible place where peace was reigning. And we had the visit of Bill Clinton to Belfast, which was a glorious, glorious time. But Harpers have been doing what we're doing for at least 2,000 years. You know, that's if we accept the Bible as a testament to history. But, I mean, certainly from the 8th century, we have harps appearing on crosses, and it's quite evident that they were part and parcel of the aristocratic Celtic social structure. And that was British-wide. I mean, we have Scotland and Wales and Ireland still, I suppose, project their Celtic heritage. But it was very much part of Britain as well, because the harpers were the most prized musicians to have at the royal courts. Mm. We have got a very integrated history in terms of our presence in the British Isles, right from at least the 8th century, just from the time we have tangible history. From the 12th century, from 1182, we have an extraordinary account by Giraldus of Wales, who was visiting in Ireland, and all that he could find that was really lovely about the Irish was the harp music, and everything else we did was pretty savage. But even at that point, our music, the music of the harpers, was remarkable. And he gives a phenomenal description, and this is just 1182, so 12th century. And after that, then, harpers became very famous in Europe. In Pretorius in Italy writes about it in the 14th century. So we've got a massive history behind us that is intriguing and, you know, gives us that touch of pride because it's worth things in between times. But music for me is very much a sharing of joy, and I play sessions regularly, and I create sessions for my students to have them enjoy music, and that's very much about enabling creativity.
That's also been at the forefront of the Irish harp revival as well, hasn't it? I mean, it's basically
been... and we had a big part to do with that, which I'm delighted to. Many of the students that came out of my orchestra are now the top, the most desired and the most revered players in Ireland. The Celtic harp has remained the baroque instrument, where you have to change the levers with a blade or a lever at the top of each string, so you change key. So it means that our music is pretty tonal. However, even within that, you can get a lot of interesting and modern effects. So we don't consider ourselves to be playing historical instruments. They're just much more socially accessible instruments because they'll play great tunes that people will want to sing.
Well, they're absolutely heavenly. Perhaps we can listen to another piece now of your choosing.
And this piece is the Laudate Domino, because it was one of Columba's favourite psalms, and it is all about praising the Lord with lute and harp. But it's with my orchestra and some wonderful singers. Raid Healy is my solo soprano.
Laudate.
Is important because I want that played at my funeral. It was the piece that really was, for me, was the high point in my career, because in 1997 we played 22 concerts with the combined choirs of the different of the two communities in Northern Ireland. I was exhausted, absolutely exhausted at the end of the year. We brought all 22 choirs together in the Belfast Waterfront Hall, and we had nearly as many people on stage as were in the audience, about 800. We performed that piece, and at the very end, I had put the words of the psalm, Laudate Dominum, on the back page of the concert programme, and as an encore, because people were delighted with what we had performed. And I turned around and conducted the audience, and I thought, I am happy to die after this piece. It was so exhilarating. So that was a high point for me. Things got very difficult for me afterwards, because I was being targeted for trouble in Northern Ireland. And in the end, I had to leave because my family were being threatened. And it was a big chapter in my life, but it was a magnificent chapter too, because it did absorb, I suppose, the prime of my life and energy. And after my time in Northern Ireland, I migrated south to Castleconnell, where I established the Irish Harp Centre. And that was a residential college and school for harping. And we had another chapter of 14 glorious years based in Limerick before I went back into academia as visiting professor of music in Derry in Northern Ireland to the Ulster University.
You've also, one of the other things you've done is you've actually written music for multiple harps, haven't you? And what did that entail? Yeah. That must have been really interesting as a project.
Oh, absolutely. Well, I think actually, having kind of given you one of the pieces that we did from my Columban suite, the idea of doing multiple harps or kind of a massed Hearts event was really about looking for an audience to start with, and that really was what was behind the creation of the orchestra, because people are used to hearing harps in hotel lounges, tea rooms, or nice little pretty music for the background of a religious service perhaps. And I found it difficult to fill a concert hall or to get out of the tiny places. I wanted to create a spectacle, because the harp is a spectacle. And that's what we did with the harp orchestra. But then when we did the masked events, because when we toured with the Columbkill piece, lots of other ensembles wanted to perform it either with us or again on their own outside, so that set me on the road of publishing my ensemble works. And we had another massive event in 2014, which was the millennium of the demise of Brian Boru, the High King of Ireland of a thousand years ago. So, and the Brian Boru's March is one of the kind of quintessential pieces. It's like a first piece that every harp player in the world will know and have played. But it's, you know, the great thing about traditional music is that you can play it as a grown-up with a grown-up arrangement, and you can play it as a novice player with the most basic arrangement, and everybody can perform this together. But I took the idea and the theme of the Brian Boru's March and created another suite which lasted the full concert. And we brought harpers, over 100 harpers together, performing in St Mary's Cathedral in Limerick, which is Brian Boru's back room. And actually the cathedral, the first cathedral's dean was Brian Boru's brother. And, you know, we have Brian Boru's fort is still, it's a heritage site out near Killaloo. We created a whole new year of festivities, and that was concurrent with the Irish City of Culture ideal that happened in Limerick. We haven't had another one since because it was fraught with political ins and outs and ministers and sackings, and, you know, there was combination of the two councils, the city council and the county council, and nobody was getting along. And it was another kind of triumph against a massively crazy background. But it was also a financial massive headache for me, because the grant that we'd been promised never came through. However, you know, my mum's legacy was spent judiciously on this event, and I did speak to her in my prayers, and I think I got her okay, and she hasn't haunted me about it since. But it was so worth doing, and that was probably one of the great triumphs as well, because we had two harp orchestras from France. By the way, we also set on fire the idea of having harp orchestras, and we had one from America. So we had a combination of a number of different places, also Italy. And it was a superb gathering and opportunity to celebrate something in history, but something that was vibrant and fun and just a real celebration in song. Well, this one that I've chosen is called Bright New Morning. And idly, I was sitting in my sitting room one day and kind of wondering, is this Declaration of Peace by the IRA in September 1994 going to actually mean anything? Because nobody expected it to really take root at the time, because we had been so accustomed to social unrest and heartache. And I thought, if we can accommodate the differences, you know, give people a sense of the fact that everything we share is common, but we fight each other and kill each other even over differences that shouldn't be so horrendous. But anyway, this piece, as you'll find, is quirky. It's halfway between a jig and a reel, but it was also about going halfway between classical and traditional music, because in Northern Ireland we like to kind of, you know, what we do implies our cultural identity. So classical music tended to be part and parcel of the identity of the Protestant elite, while traditional music was regarded to be the country music of the nationalist culture. And all of this is so spurious, and it is not absolutely the case. It might, you know, be a 60-40 idea, but it's not a clear-cut thing. So what I wanted to do was to bring all of those changes on board. And of course, we performed it with my half-Protestant, half-Catholic orchestra. So it's called Bright New Morning, and it was also composed for the coming of Bill Clinton to Belfast to turn on the Christmas lights in November 1994.
Janet Harbison, thank you very much indeed for coming on to Cambridge 105. That sounds wonderful. We'll listen to it now. The idea of being stabbed through the back of your reading chair with a hat pin unceremoniously, with no one knowing who did you in, chilled me greatly in a Miss Marple thriller by Agatha Christie. It scares us deeply, so we're naturally curious as to who done it and why. Murder by the Book, a celebration of 20th century British crime fiction exhibition, is currently running at Cambridge University Library and looks at the detective thriller from a variety of new angles. Thriller writer Nicola Upson curated a show that brings murder mysteries to life and contrasts literary fiction and crime fiction genre. Chris Burgess is head of exhibition and public programmes at the UL and thankfully wasn't wearing black gloves as he took me into his office for an interview on what the show contains, which runs until August the 24th. Tell me a little bit about Nicola Upson, because she's a thriller writer herself.
Yeah, she's a crime writer. She is based in Cambridge, and she writes a series of books based on a golden age crime writer who's a bit forgotten now, perhaps unfairly, called Josephine Tay. And Nicola puts Josephine Tay at the centre of her books, and Josephine helps solve crimes.
And I can see that in the exhibition, Josephine Tay's book covers are there. Are those first editions?
They are all first editions, yeah.
What do you think it is about the Brits that makes attracts them so much to the world of crime thrillers?
It's a really great question. I think one of the things is that's come across, which perhaps we don't think about crime, because often it deals with very, you know, macabre subjects, murder, for instance. But actually, there's a kind of the humanity at its heart. It's the fact that every life matters. You know, you have to solve every single murder, which is a key to most crime writing. And I think that's one reason why people return to it again and again. I think, again, the other thing is a sense of justice. There's a kind of sense of justice and a kind of morality, I think, that runs through most crime books. It's key to the genre. And I think that's one reason why we return again. It's not just Brits. We've had, like, real interest from, like, Agatha Christie's really big in China. And so there's been a real interest in, I think there's a real interest in British crime writing in China in particular. So that's been something that we weren't anticipating, but it's been really, like, welcome part of the exhibition.
I think the Cambridge audience really liked the intellectual puzzle involved in these things. That was a comment which Stuart Payson Walsh made to me at one point. Yeah. That they have to have something that they can puzzle the mind with and solve.
And I think that's absolutely right. Jill obviously is in the exhibition, which is nice. Crime typically has a kind of twist, if we're calling it that, at the end. And I think readers, they like to be able to solve the twist or they like to be tricked by the author into what the twist is. Perhaps it went down around a different route. So that's interesting. And I think that's, again, one reason why people return to the genre again and again.
What's the narrative of the exhibition? What's it exploring?
So the exhibition is seen through the eyes of a writer, through Nicola Rupson. And rather than being chronological, it's thematic, and it's broken down into the themes that almost all crime novels have, the thing that makes crime novels what they are. So things about setting, which is always key to crime writing, detectives, the victim, the criminal, the twist, and also, again, returning to this idea of morality when crime novels kind of touch on very things close to things that society is interested in. So, for instance, there were quite a lot of crime writers who were interested in the death penalty before it was abolished in the UK, and through a number of books, it helped highlight, the death penalty should be abolished. The themes of the exhibition follow the themes of the genre, if that makes sense.
And you're contrasting literary fiction with crime fiction genre as well. Why is that?
Crime is the most read genre. It's the one the most read in the UK. But it's perhaps the least spoken about. We don't talk, and it's certainly the sells the most, but we don't talk about it in the same way that we talk about literary fiction. I think what the exhibition makes the point is it's a bit of an arbitrary kind of separation. Like, crime novel at its very best is as good as any literary fiction. And, Christie proved that. And also some of the great canons of the literary within literature. So Rebecca by Daphne du Maurier, which is in the exhibition, is a crime novel. It follows all the kind of the conceits of a crime novel, yet isn't really considered one, and that's one of the things the exhibition explores.
You have a very rich crime collection here.
Yeah, that's the reason why we put on the exhibition, was because I first arrived at the library in the tower of the Cambridge University Library. If you've not been, it's very, very tall. It's got a huge tower on the top of it. It's full of kind of material that was collected under copyright, which was deemed at the time secondary, so not academic, is now very well consulted by academics. But things like cookbooks, romance fiction, all this kind of stuff, and including that is in hundreds of thousands of crime novels, first editions, all in their original dust jackets. And one of the ideas we had, it would be great to do an exhibition using these, and we were just waiting for a curator, and then we met Nicola and it all came together.
Now this library is like an enormous honeycomb of books. It's just the most fantastic library. You haven't found any bodies lying around anywhere?
We've not found any bodies in the library, no.
Okay, so now take me through the authors that you're showcasing, because obviously you've got Agatha Christie, and you've even got her typewriter and her, yeah, her recorder, so real things that Agatha Christie worked with, which is tremendous as well.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's one of the things that we were very, very lucky to be able to borrow from the Agatha Christie Archive Trust, and they were really happy to lend another items, the typewriter, as you say, the dictaphone, but also some of her notebooks, the Lord Chamberlain's copy of The Mousetrap, which went to him before it was allowed on the London stage, also the typescript of the very last Poirot novel, which was written by Christie at the very start of the Second World War, but kept in a bank vault until the 70s. She was basically worried she was going to die, so she wrote the last Poirot novel, and then it was published right at the very end of her life. So it was amazing to borrow those things from the collection. But it's not just about those crime novelists who we know loads about. So it's not just about Christie. One of the things that Nicola's done is to bring out real classic exemplars from different, like, what are the best books that show this idea of setting. So Reginald Hill, who wrote a series of crime novels with Dalziel and Pascoe at their heart, which then became a very, very famous TV adaptation. On Beulah Height is his classic, this kind of Yorkshire, sort of Halifax, Todmorden, that sort of area. And you get a sense of the place, if that makes sense. And so she's managed to pull out a whole series of novels, which, perhaps are forgotten now, but really showcase the genre to its height. So hopefully it's not just, you don't just come and learn about Agatha Christie, you also get a real other books to read. And the other thing that's really interesting is the fact that because it's not chronological, it's thematic, you can get books talking to each other in slightly different ways. So one of the very first crime novels, not quite the first, but one of the very first, is Wilkie Collins' The Moonstone, which is about the theft of a diamond. I won't say what happens, but we've also got a book by Mike Phillips, which is called The Dancing Face, which is about Benin bronze. It's written in 1997, and the theft and repatriation of a Benin bronze. And you can see these novels talking to each other, even though they were written a very long time apart. but covering the same sort of themes.
Now, obviously, you bring these novels to life because you've got lots of film clips to, for people to come and have a look
at,
both in the exhibition room and on the first floor of the on the main floor of the library. Those are great because you've got people like Alfred Hitchcock saying wonderful things like murder used to be a private affair that only happened between friends and at home. And he was very concerned about the fact that murder was on the decline with this sort of tongue-in-cheek humour. That was a great little clip, I thought.
I think it's that kind of things that really brings the exhibition to life, like the stories of the quotes from the writers and stuff, and from Hitchcock as well. Obviously, Hitchcock saw it very early, is the fact that often our most famous... the most famous detectives are brought to life on the screen, but that doesn't seem to put people off wanting to return to the books.
The artwork on the books is really good as well, isn't it? Because that's really interesting to look at how those have all been designed over the years.
The UL famously has never got rid of any of its dust jackets from its books, unlike our relatives in Oxford and at the British Library. So we have this amazing collection of dust jackets, which are lots of academics and researchers come to study the dust jackets because they're interested in the history of design. One of the things why we did the exhibition, because we knew we had these amazing dust jackets in the collection. The exhibition runs until the Saturday, the 24th of August. So do please come along.
That's absolutely fantastic. Thank you very much indeed, Chris Burgess.
In modern life's rat race, it sometimes feels as if technology has got us by the short and curlies and won't let go, and it's all moving too fast to take stock of and to understand. Cambridge artist Robert Good has recently been to Silicon Valley to look at how technology impacts on society and our lives, and he was deeply influenced by what he saw and wanted to ask some topical questions in his latest exhibition, They Work, We Sleep, co-curated by artist Liz Brady. It's part of a series on how tech encroaches ever further into daily life and how the boundaries between the digital and physical worlds blur. It kicks off on the 18th of May at Quip and Curiosity, a contemporary art space in Tennyson Road in Cambridge, at midday and runs until the 2nd of June. Robert Good previews the show.
I suppose I'd call myself an experimental artist. I'm interested in ideas. I'm interested in exploring different things. And in the exhibition that's upcoming, I'm going to be thinking about the relationship of technology and our lives and how that affects us.
Now, there's lots of issues involved in technology in our lives. I mean, in fact, it's at the forefront of society at the moment with the advent of AI and this whole stepping off the linear thing that we had in the past. What kind of issues are you picking up on?
So some things like the addictiveness, how we keep coming back to things is one thing. Another thing is I've got a little piece on face recognition and how, you know, our identities are grabbed whether we want it or not. You know, you accept cookies in order to go to a website and suddenly your whole life history is kind of uploaded onto the web and given to all these people whether you really want it or not. So all of these dynamics around how we use it, and also information and the information overload and how much information we keep getting fed and comes through to us. So it's a chance for people to step back, I suppose, and reflect on it.
Now, this was spawned originally from your trip to Silicon Valley in 2022. Now, what were you doing in Silicon Valley?
Well, I thought, if I'm going to be interested in the art in the digital age, maybe I can go to the heart, you know, the heart of it all, and find the home of the internet in Silicon Valley. But I didn't really find it, but it was an absolutely amazing experience because it did give me the chance to reflect on our relationship to technology. And quite by chance, I came across an art collective called the School of Visual Philosophy, and they were doing all this, as it were, analog stuff, metalwork and printing and drawing and so on. And it was so totally at the opposite end of the scale to the digital world that it really threw the two into contrast. And so I suddenly thought to myself, yes, that's what I want to explore. I want to take the digital and kind of make it a little bit more analog, make it slow it down a little bit, make it a little bit more, you know.
It's the kind of idea that we have this huge wave coming towards us of technology which we feel we don't really understand it or its implications or how it works, and there's this kind of struggle to surf the wave, as it were, and wrestle
with it. And I suppose eventually it's about achieving a kind of mastery over how this new normal technological life is going to be.
Well, I think you put your finger on it, because actually it's so difficult. That's what's so difficult, is to find any masteries. You know, are we waving or drowning? You know, we're more and more is expected of us in terms of, you know, being able to keep up with the latest. So we're being asked to do more and more in terms of keeping up with everything, and it's almost impossible to do so. So actually slowing down and trying to step back from it provides us a chance to disconnect and reconsider, okay, actually, what do we really want from all of this?
Yeah, I think that having a more examined understanding of what life with it is going to mean is an important concept.
Exactly, and getting it to work on our terms and not on Google's terms or Facebook's terms or whoever, Meta, so that it's really to enable us and to help us.
Okay, so what are the features of the installations in the exhibition?
Well, I don't want to kind of give too much away, because I want it to be an encounter, so people come along and they're going to be surprised by some of them. But there will be some interactive artworks there, and there will be kind of some face recognition, as I say, and there'll be some motion sensors as well. And there will be cats as well. Cats, for me, are kind of a bit like, we all post up pictures of our lovely cats on the internet, and we end up scrolling through all of these pictures of cats. They're kind of another time waster online. So there will be cats throughout the exhibition. A few might meow, and they might kind of respond to you if you're nice to them. And then there will be, I've got a truth bot as well, which is just wandering through Wikipedia, reporting back on all the myriad information there. And there are various digital ones, and then there are going to be a few more posters and things that are analogue, as it were, to go with it. Because I've been... So the title is called They Live, We Sleep, and it's a reference to a 1988 movie called They Live, which is a kind of schlock horror in which they realise that the world is being run by aliens, and behind all the advertising are all these things that are kind of keeping us hooked, keeping us in our place, keeping us where we are. And so it's a little bit of a reference to that, in that a lot of social media, it seems to be very benign and so on, but it keeps us hooked, it keeps us in our place, it keeps us just where we are. So They Live, the internet giants are doing their stuff, and we're kind of made semi-comatose by all the stuff that we're having to process. It plays with ideas, it plays, as you say, with what's the current zeitgeist, and technology really is, you know, left, right and centre. And so I'm hoping that my exhibition will encourage these conversations, and it will be a chance for people to step back and reflect on some of these issues.
I've been to lots of your art shows and they've been really good so far. So Robert, thank you very much indeed for talking to Cambridge 105.
Thank you so much for having me.
And that's all we have time for today, and I hope you enjoyed listening in on Cambridge 105, and we'll tune in again when I have more to tell of in Cambridge's Art Dimension, which never ceases to amaze me in its breadth and complexity. I'm Simon Bertin, and I'll be back on air soon.
Need legal advice you can trust? Woodfine Solicitors offers a range of expert and award-winning legal services, whatever your problem. Running a business can be stressful enough. Without having to tackle legal problems, such as contracts or disputes, Woodfines can help. Our expert team will advise you on what's best for your business, large or small, and offer high-level technical advice on a whole spectrum of issues. And we're upfront and transparent about our costs. Find out more about what we offer at woodfines.co.uk. Woodfines. Cutting through the red tape.